Hey guys, welcome back to another medical update when it comes to President Trump's diagnosis of COVID-19. As a pulmonary and critical care doctor, I'm watching Dr. Sean Conley, who is President Trump's physician, give a press conference along with the rest of his medical team, which includes three pulmonary and critical care doctors, two infectious disease doctors, an anesthesiologist, as well as a clinical pharmacist, nurses. It's obvious that Dr. Conley is choosing to withhold certain medical details. So in this video, I'm going to take what he's saying with the information that's being given to us and do my best to read between the lines so that people can have a real understanding of what is going on here with President Trump. And I'm going to try to classify the severity of his COVID-19 illness because it's not an easy thing to do. At the end of this video, I'm going to talk about what this means for President Trump's health moving forward. So let's go ahead and take a look at what was being said during the press conference. So he starts out by saying that President Trump continues to improve. As with any course of illness, there are frequent ups and downs, especially when being monitored closely. This is very true. Now, I work in the intensive care unit a lot, and there's going to be fluctuations of everything, pulse oximetry, blood pressure, heart rate. These things fluctuate. So it is true. Now, I'm not saying President Trump is in the ICU. He's not. He's far from it. But the point being is with more frequent monitoring, there are going to be fluctuations. He then goes on to say that President Trump has these transient dips in his oxygenation, and therefore they started dexamethasone, and I'm going to come back to that in a bit. He says that Thursday night, when he was first diagnosed, the oxygen saturation was in the high 90s. Then late Friday morning, the oxygen transiently dipped below 94%, and that's when he recommended supplemental oxygen. He says Trump didn't want it, but he did end up giving 2 liters of supplemental oxygen, so very minimal. And that was on for about an hour, and then his oxygen saturations did climb, and he no longer needed the oxygen supplementation. Dr. Conley convened with the rest of the medical team that day and decided they should bring President Trump into Walter Reed Medical Center, and that's how they came to that conclusion. Then Dr. Dooley steps to the microphone and says that he continues to improve. He doesn't have any fever. His vital signs are stable. He's not requiring supplemental oxygen. He's ambulating, meaning he's walking around. He also says that his cardiac, liver, and kidney function are normal or improving. That's interesting to me because yesterday they said his liver and kidney is normal. So why did he add or improving today? You know, one possibility coming out of that would be perhaps President Trump has elevated troponin levels. Elevated troponin levels are relatively frequent in hospitalized patients, no matter what reason they are in the hospital for. So with elevated troponin levels, depending on how high they are, that could be reflective of someone having a heart attack, a myocardial infarction. But we don't know how high the troponin levels were. If they were elevated, this is all speculation. And if he did have a heart attack, they would know based on not only the troponin level, but in conjunction with an EKG, echocardiogram. So that's not what's going on here. It's possible he has a very slight elevated troponin level that's now downward trending. But again, we don't know for sure. If they gave us the testing results, there wouldn't have to be the speculation. So then Dr. Garibaldi, who's also a pulmonary and critical care doctor, steps to the microphone and tells us that he's completed his second dose of remdesivir yesterday, and he's not having any side effects related to that. So the concern with remdesivir is it can impair liver and or kidney function. And so far, he's not had any side effects from that remdesivir when it comes to liver kidneys. He also says that they're planning on discharging President Trump as early as tomorrow. So then reporters start asking questions, and the answers that we get from Dr. Conley says that yesterday he had another episode of oxygen desaturation where it went down to 93%. They watched it, and then the oxygen saturation went higher after that. He's unsure if they gave more supplemental oxygen yesterday. And he says if they did, it was very minimal. He specifically asked if the X-ray and the CAT scan shows anything, any signs of pneumonia or lung involvement. And then he says there are some expected findings, but nothing of clinical concern. So if his chest X-ray was normal, if his CAT scan was normal, if his lung ultrasound was normal, you would say it's normal or it's unremarkable. The fact that he says it's expected findings, well, the way that I interpret that is someone has COVID-19, especially with pulmonary or respiratory symptoms like cough, shortness of breath, or with lower oxygen levels, that to me means there's going to be an infiltrate on the lung imaging study. So there's going to be evidence of viral pneumonia, this ground glass opacity that we would see. And that would be the expected finding. So when he says there are expected findings, that tells me that's what's on that CAT scan. That's what's on that chest X-ray. That's what's on that lung ultrasound. So he has COVID-19 pneumonia. There's viral pneumonia based on my interpretation of what's being told to us. Now, I want to talk about COVID-19 disease severity. As of right now, there are no strict definitions of classification of disease severity. What constitutes mild versus moderate versus severe illness versus critical illness is very much a gray area. Now, generally speaking, someone who has symptoms but is not short of breath and does not have low oxygen levels, this would be considered mild COVID-19. Moderate illness is characterized by shortness of breath and or low oxygen levels with evidence of viral pneumonia seen on a chest X-ray or CAT scan of the lungs or even ultrasound of the lungs. Severe illness is characterized by someone who's having trouble breathing and consistently requires extra oxygen and or ventilatory support. Then there's critical illness, which is when patients have either ARDS and or hypotension to the point where they're requiring very high levels of oxygen and or ventilatory support. So this can include things like high flow nasal cannula or mechanical ventilation, either non-invasive mechanical ventilation or invasive mechanical ventilation. Non-invasive ventilation means things like bilevel or BiPAP. That's where we give a mask and we strap it to the head and it's right on that face there and there's no leakage or there should be no leakage. And with that, you're blowing two different pressures. So one for inhalation, one for exhalation. So when someone takes a breath in, there's a higher pressure. And then when they breathe out, there's a lower pressure. That's called bilevel ventilation. That's non-invasive ventilation. Invasive ventilation is when someone has a breathing tube in, so it goes down the throat, and that's hooked up to a breathing machine, a ventilator. So these are things that would be categorized as critically ill COVID-19 illness. But again, defining the severity of illness is hard to do because there's no strict definitions. And this also makes it tricky in terms of what medication to give. For example, these studies show dexamethasone, which is a type of steroid, specifically a type of glucocorticoid. This reduces mortality in moderate and severe disease, but not in mild disease. But again, what defines mild versus moderate versus severe? It's still very much a gray area. So for doctors to try and convey medical updates to patients and families, and in this case to the public, it's hard to give crystal clear answers. The rationale behind giving dexamethasone is that it can suppress inflammation within the body. So the hope is that it'll suppress the inflammation that takes place within the lungs. For COVID-19, we give dexamethasone in either IV or pill form. It's 6 milligrams once a day, and we give it for a total duration of 10 days. One of the side effects that always occurs with steroids is that patients' blood sugar levels become higher, so hyperglycemia. And that is why we sometimes have to counteract that by giving someone insulin. Now, the concern when you give someone insulin is that you can drop the blood sugar too low to the point of causing hypoglycemia, and that in itself causes a whole other set of problems. So we have to counteract the hypoglycemia by giving someone sugar, and it's this kind of game of back and forth. Typically, when we give dexamethasone, we do check blood sugar levels by doing finger sticks, and that's usually done every 4 or 6 hours when someone's in the hospital getting steroids. Now, in this press conference, they mentioned nothing about this, but if his blood sugars were out of whack, they would not be talking about doing discharge planning. So my presumption is that his blood sugars are doing okay. If the doctors wanted to be credible, they would provide results of diagnostic tests. That's the best way that they can be transparent, bottom line. This would include giving results of his lung imaging, whether that's chest X-ray, CAT scan, lung ultrasound. This would include giving results of his blood work, such as his CBC, his complete blood count. What did his white blood cell count show? There's different types of white blood cells, and we know that with lymphocytes, which is a type of white blood cell, those are lower in more severe disease of COVID-19. Other diagnostic testing I want to know the results of are his D-dimer levels. Typically, when D-dimer levels are high with COVID-19, there's a much higher chance of someone having a blood clot. Also, how high are his ferritin levels? The higher the level of ferritin, the more inflammation there is within the body. The other thing is albumin levels. The lower the albumin levels are, the poorer the prognosis tends to be. And like I mentioned, the same thing when it comes to lymphocyte count? Did he have an ultrasound of the legs looking for clot in the legs? Did he have a CT angio, a CAT scan of the lungs with an angiogram looking for blood clots in the lungs? Did he have that done? Did he have an echocardiogram? Was his echocardiogram normal? That's an ultrasound of the heart. Presumably, it is normal. But stepping back and looking at this from a bird's eye view, where does Trump lie on the spectrum of COVID-19 illness? Right now, his oxygen saturation is 98%. He's not requiring supplemental oxygen. What would progression of his illness look like if he were to have clinical deterioration? Well, typically, this entails stepping up his oxygen therapy. So he could be put on 2 liters nasal cannula, maybe 3, 4, 5. If that's still not enough oxygen, maybe an oxygen face mask or something called high flow nasal cannula. These devices provide a lot more oxygen than a nasal cannula. If these are still not enough, that's when you start talking about mechanical ventilation, either non-invasive mechanical ventilation, meaning like a BiPAP mask, or with invasive mechanical ventilation with a breathing tube and being on a ventilator, a breathing machine. And lots of times, patients who require a breathing tube and a ventilator, these are the patients who also often require blood pressure support with vasopressors. So things like Levofed, which is norepinephrine, or vasopressin. These are medications we give IV to stimulate the blood pressure, which can happen in someone who's in shock or has ARDS. So that would be the sickest of the sick. It's the ones who are mechanically ventilated, requiring 100% oxygen. And sometimes even that is not enough. And that's why some patients end up getting ECMO, ECMO, or extra corporal membranous oxygenation. That's essentially where we take blood out of the body, we pump it out of the body, pump it back in. And when we do that, we are putting oxygen into that blood and extracting carbon dioxide from that blood. But that is a very risky procedure, and that's only done in the most extreme circumstances. And sometimes, despite us doing all these things, patients still end up dying. That is just the reality of this disease. So with the bird's eye view, President Trump is nowhere near that end of the spectrum. He's much closer to the opposite end of the spectrum. He's not requiring supplemental oxygen. In other words, he's breathing in the same air that I'm breathing in, which is 21% oxygen. That's room air. My oxygen saturation right now is 100%. His is 98%, and we're both breathing the same amount of oxygen. So his respiratory status is very stable right now. But the important thing to keep in mind is that patients with COVID-19 can look like they're doing fine. They can have improvement in their symptoms. They can have improvement with their oxygenation. And within hours, clinically deteriorate to the point of requiring mechanical ventilation, especially when the inflammatory phase of the illness becomes very prominent, meaning the cytokine storm that can develop. Typically, that's done or that happens around day 7 to day 10 of the illness. So obviously, they're going to keep a close eye on him still throughout these upcoming days and probably upcoming weeks as well. And we'll have to see what happens. So I'm going to end this video on that note. Thanks for watching, and I'm going to continue to watch this closely and make another video on it. So if you haven't already, make sure you subscribe and hit that bell notification as well. That way you get notified of when my next one comes out.